Hello, Protrusive. I'm Jazz Galati, and welcome back to this second part of the group function. So we split it into two. On the first group function, if you haven't listened to it already, it was, can I probe that implant? Is it cool to probe around implants? Because there was a myth that you may scratch the implant. So is there any truth to that? Should we be concerned? That's all covered in part one. In this part two, I've got Dr. Pav Khaira. We're talking about what is the normal amount of bone loss around an implant. So when I am reviewing patients who had implants placed elsewhere, potentially, and I take a periapical radiograph, and it's been 5 years since they had their implant, am I expecting bone loss? At what point do I get concerned, and what point should I refer? So we're going to find that out. And another very interesting controversial issue is, how do you as a GDP manage a screw loosening? So if the implant crown is loose, is it cool for us to be going in and tightening it? What about if you don't have the right equipment? Or how do you even identify which system it is? You have to stock every single driver there is. The very real world question there. And I think Pav does great justice. So let's hear it from Pav, and I'll catch you in the outro. When you see a radiograph of an implant, let's say a periapical, and I don't know when this implant was done, I can ask the patient. The patient's like, long time ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. They'll give me a vague answer. But anyway, am I expecting ever, is it acceptable to have threads exposed supracrestal, i.e. All the threads are not in the bone, some of the threads are outside the bone. Is this acceptable? And B, what amount of bone loss is normal? Because I understand that after you place an implant, after about a year, you expect to lose some. You're probably going to say, yes, but I do all this crazy voodoo magic that they don't lose any bone. But for the average implant, what is normal in terms of bone loss?
So historically, what's been considered acceptable is, as a rule of thumb, bone loss down to the first thread, then about 0.2 millimeters per year. As you quite rightly said, that is the modern techniques and the modern concepts, we really shouldn't be seeing anything at all. But you know what? I see loads of patients where they come in to see me where they've had implants placed 20 years ago, okay? And I think the issue is in the absence of any inflammatory responses like what we've discussed about before. There's no bleeding, there's no suppuration, the implant's been there 20 years. If you've got a 15, 18 millimeter long implant, or you've got 3 millimeters of threads exposed, I'm really not bothered about it, okay? If an implant was placed last year and I've got 3 millimeters of threads exposed, all of a sudden I am bothered about it. So I think it very much depends on the case. And with regards to how many threads are acceptable to be supracrestal, again, that depends on the implant, okay? Because some implants, like the Southern that I use, the top 3 or 4 threads, it's actually a machined surface. So if there are threads exposed, it's not really that impactful. It's not really that significant. But if you had an implant such as Nobel, they integrate nicely. But if you look at the surface topography of them, it's tiny little caves. So what happens is, as soon as that's exposed and you start to get inflammation, it zips down the surface of the implant. So it depends as to the surface treatment of the implant. As a general rule of thumb, you should see a bone loss down to the first thread in the first year. But even then, I wouldn't be overly happy with that. But I think if you're taking consecutive radiographs and you see everything's nice and stable, then why should we bother an intervent and do something, right? If you're taking PAs once a year and over a 5 year period, if in year one you've had 2 millimeters bone loss and no bone loss since then, it's a stable outcome. But if every single year you're losing 1 millimeter, 0.5 millimeter, that's obviously then an issue. We need to intervene and do something. So again, I'm sorry, it's not a clear cut, but...
Nothing's clear cut, but that's a useful guideline, Pav. I really appreciate that, because it's a bit like our periodontal patients. Age is a factor, and obviously age of teeth, in your case, age of implants, we can apply similar logic to that. So that makes perfect sense. And I think that will help the Protrusive listening and the have you got a word for the dental implant podcast listeners? Have your listeners, have they got like a fan word?
I've used the term titanium nerds a few times.
Say that again, titanium nerds.
Titanium nerds, yeah.
Okay, I love it. Titanium nerds. Okay, so protrusorati, titanium nerds. I hope you're getting some value from that. I imagine the titanium nerds are, I just know all of this stuff already, but maybe someone who's interested in implants and interested in getting into implants, and this might be helpful because they're seeing patients and they're helping to maintain implants, which is what this episode is about. So my last question is now that emergency phone call you get, the nurse says, or the reception says, okay, there's a patient with a loose implant. The first time I had this, this is embarrassing. The first time I had this as a DF1, patient came in and the crown was spinning. And in my head, I thought, wow, this is like a grade 3 mobile tooth. I don't know. I think the implant's spinning. So I called my trainer and I said, hey, Reg, I think the implants are like fully loose, but the x-ray looks okay. What's going on? And he just like took out the access cavity restoration, just tightened it by a quarter turn, and that was it. And I was like, wow, that was so easy. And then later on, when I got to do this, one of the implant dentists told me that, Jazz, you know, I read your notes, you tightened it too tight. And I'm like, I didn't know. What was I supposed to tighten it to? Because that's what Nobel taught me when I went on a course once. So, A, do you think all general dentists should know how to manage this emergency? And B, any guidelines, any helpful things that you can tell us? Is there a standardized number of newtons that we're tightening to, for example? Is the kit standardized? Am I expected to have all these kits?
So this is a real bugbear, and it's a real pain in the backside for me, because there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of different implant systems out there. They all use different screw heads. They all use different torques. It can be due to a number of different problems. It could be screw loosening. It could be what's called the titanium base that's come loose. It could be the hex that's threaded. It could be the implant head that's fractured. And you're basically taking a shot in the dark with this type of stuff. What I would probably recommend to a general dentist who doesn't place implants, the only thing that you should really be looking at doing is, at the most, is tightening it finger tight and then sending it to somebody else to deal with, okay? Because I had a patient come out to see me. So what I never do is I never just retighten screws. Always have to order a brand new screw, okay? So I've had a couple of patients recently come out to see me. The work's absolutely beautiful. It's come loose. So what I'll do is I'll hand tighten it. I'll say to them, I've got to order new screws. I'm going to swap the screws over. Because screws become stressed and they become strained. That may be one of the reasons why it's come loose. And if you retighten a strained screw, you can cause it to break. Then you're in trouble because you may not be able to retrieve it from the implant head. So you only want to tighten it to finger tightness, and then you want to refer it on somebody else to deal with. So the issue that you have is certain systems like Ankylos, they're quite happy to take 15 to 20 newton centimeters. The southern implants that I use take 40 newton centimeters. If you get it wrong, you're going to give yourself a problem. So you need to know exactly which system it is. And there have been a number of occasions where I haven't known what system it is, and I've had to take an educated shot in the dark. And that's all that I can do. So the answer to that question is are you going to see it? Yes, you are. Okay. And I think another big aspect, another big problem that this is caused by is very frequently when dentists get the lab work back from the lab, they'll use the same screw that the lab's been using. They won't order a new screw. And I'd say historically, that's what I used to do because I didn't know any better. But people are like, why should I spend another 40, 50 quid on a new screw and all that when there's one that's here? Thing is, the lab's been screwing it on and off, and that screw's strained. It's not appropriate for use anymore. So this is something that Riaz and I discussed in our podcast as well, is the lab should order a brand new lab screw and you should get a brand new prosthetic screw for every single case. You should not be reusing impression copings. You should not be reusing lab analogs. You should not be reusing healing abutments. Everything should be fresh, brand new for every single case. The other issue that you can have, remember we spoke about this lollipop type appearance on a number of occasions.
Yep.
So another issue that you have is, particularly in molar sites, is if you've got a narrow implant which has had a small healing abutment on it, and the lab is, they're trying to create some sort of contour to the crown, quite often the lab will put on a little bit of compression onto the gums to try to give it some sort of contour as it's coming out. And what happens is, as you're torquing it down, let's say you're torquing it down to 35 newton centimeters, that compression is going onto the soft tissue, not onto the actual interface itself. So you get patients back quite quickly with loose crowns.
Yeah, because all that's happening is the soft tissue is getting compressed, but the screw is not engaging where it should be, right?
Yeah, so the screw's not fully seated. It's partly seated. And sometimes you get away with it, but a lot of the times you don't. So my protocol is, A, make sure that the crown's completely passive as it's going in. I will then torque my my abutment to whatever torque it is, depending on which implant it is that I'm using. I will then wait 10 minutes, and then I will retorque it. Because retorquing after 10 minutes makes sure that everything's really nice and secure.
Amazing. But that makes perfect sense. But I think the message for someone like me, which I took away from that, is if in doubt, which I'll always be in doubt because I don't know which system was used, I'm going to finger tighten it and send it back to the person if I don't know what brand of implant is. And I've got my implant placing dentist who comes in once a week. You know, they can easily deal with that. And I'm sure they'd be grateful that they get an opportunity to properly deal with that, however they would, like you would. So I think finger tightening is something that a lot of dentists can do. And the drivers, the universal ones, are they as universal as the name suggests?
No, they're not. They're just called universal drivers. But they're just...
Oh, my goodness.
It depends what extent you want to go to. You can get little kits for about £300-400, which you've got loads of different drivers in, and you just try whichever one. So the case that I had today, I knew which implant brand it had, but when it was originally placed, it was over-torched to the head of the screw had stripped. So getting it on and off was really... So even with the correct driver, getting it on and off was really difficult, okay? So you can have 0.9 drivers, you can have 1.2 millimeters drivers, you can have 1.22 millimeter drivers. Straumann have got their own driver. Nobel have got their own driver. Neodent, they've made their driver similar to Nobel. It's called the Unigrip driver, okay? But Nobel's Unigrip driver and Neodent's Uni driver, they look almost identical, but they don't fit in the same way. If all companies said, we're going to have a standardized universal driver, that'd be one of the best things ever, but it's just not going to happen.
It's not going to happen. Just like Apple's not going to switch to USB-C and get rid of their white thing in the buggy that you have to buy. It's just not going to happen, and you can see why. But mate, that has been so helpful. So we have covered in this episode probing. Can you probe? Yes, you can, but take a look at the radiograph first, because those lollipop ones, good luck. It ain't happening. Threads that are exposed, kind of like perio. You have to, depends on the patient's age, or i.e. the implant age, not the patient age, the age of the implant, and that should guide you. And the loose implant, perhaps consider finger tightening it and sending it back to someone who can deal with it in a more comprehensive manner, like you would. So, Protrusive, I know you'll have found that helpful. Titanium nerds, I hope you did, because you guys are like, you've been following Pav. Pav's taught you so much already. So we could have easily gone on for like 5 hours talking about each minutia. You just have so much knowledge in there that I want to extract. But please, for those people who haven't heard your podcast, Pav, tell us, remind us how you can listen, how you can tune in, and what's next on the horizon for your podcast.
So it's the Dental Implant Podcast on Spotify, iTunes, and Google Podcasts. Inspired by yourself, Jazz. I've said this before. You're the one that said to me, Pav, you got a lot of knowledge. You need to get it out there. So it's aimed at kind of like beginners and those kind of like partway through the implant training pathway. There is stuff on there for more knowledgeable people, but they tend to know a lot of this stuff already. And I just cover so many different topics. I mean, as you said, I could write a lecture just on screws. Which mm-hmm. could last 2 or 3 hours. I can then write a lecture on how to tighten screws for another 2 hours. So, it goes into a
with
lot.
With all the complications in there and whatnot.
Yeah. And how to avoid complications, and what we should and what we shouldn't be doing, taking apart the bad signs, etc. So I just try to, again, I always say, look, it's my perspective. This is how I do things. This is my interpretation of the data. You don't have to agree with it. You don't have to like it. But as you know, you can take one topic and you'll get two people arguing both sides of the coin. They're both right. But I just want to help people deliver better care for their patients. This is one of the reasons why, I mentor people as well. So when people say, Pav, I want to learn how to place immediate molar implants. It's like, fine, not a problem. Let's show you how to do it. Bring your patients to me. This is why we do, the Evo experience at Evo Dental, where you just come shadow us for a day, see what we do. because before I started at Eva Dental, I thought I was proficient at full arches, but what we do there is just, I wouldn't do a full arch externally because of the way that the place is set up. So I'm very passionate about dental implants and trying to help others be just as passionate and get better outcomes for their patients. Because, you know, it goes back to what we were discussing today, you know, is if I can teach dentists how to develop emergence profile properly, you're not going to have these issues. If I can teach them how to place crowns properly and have soft tissue adhesion to the neck of it, we're not going to have these issues in the future. So, you know, that's just my passion. That's the reason why I'm doing it, basically.
And if anyone needed one more reason to listen to Pav's podcast, he hired Morgan Freeman to do the intro. Can you believe it? He got Morgan Freeman to do the introduction. If you haven't listened to it, you have to listen to it right now. Scroll on, go on Spotify, type in the Dental Implant Podcast, listen to the intro. You will love it. Pav, thank you so much for giving you... Thank you so much for giving me your time. Really appreciate it. Thanks for all your mentorship and help. And I think everyone, I gained so much value. I know what to do a little bit more now around those three scenarios, which confuse me every time. So I'm no longer going to have my head in the sand now. Really appreciate it and hope you have a fantastic weekend. There we have it, guys. Hope you enjoyed this group function series. It's always a pleasure to do this. And Pav was just amazing. He answered it really well, both parts of him. So Pav, thank you so much. Do check out the Dental Implant Podcast if you haven't already. And I'll catch you in the next episode, guys. Be sure to join the Protrusive Dental Community on Facebook.